Good evening, everyone. My name is Sapan Ghai. I am Chief Commercial Officer of Sovereign Metals. Why am I going to take up the next half an hour of your evening? Well, I want you to think back to all the proactive investor evenings you've probably been to, all the videos you've seen, all the podcasts you've listened to about investing, and really think whether a mining development company has ever stood up in front of you and said that it is targeting to become the world's largest and lowest cost producer with the lowest emissions in producing two critical minerals from one deposit. And those two critical minerals are titanium in the form of rutile and natural graphite. That's essentially Sovereign Metals in a nutshell. Disclaimers and disclosures. One quick point I'll make on here. We are ASX listed as well as AIM listed. So we have quite strict and strict duties in terms of our disclosures when it comes to the ASX, which is obviously a regulated market. Right, our investment highlights. Well, why even bother looking at Sovereign Metals? Well, it's a true, genuine tier one deposit hosting two critical minerals for which China currently dominates supply. Those two minerals, as I said, titanium in the form of rutile and graphite. Our project in Malawi, Cassia, is the world's largest rutile deposit ever found. It is, because of the size of it and the nature of it, also the second largest flake graphite resource globally. In July 2023, we welcomed Rio Tinto onto our share register as a 15% shareholder. They got their 15% for the privilege of $40 million. That will help us advance the definitive feasibility study at Cassia. Prior to the definitive feasibility study, we had done a PFS, a pre-feasibility study. We had completed that in September 2023. That had demonstrated that we would be the largest producer of rutile and graphite. We would be the lowest cost producer. And the numbers that we're looking at is for 25 years of an initial mine life, we could produce an average annual EBITDA, so your essentially your gross profit, of $415 million per year for 25 years. Over those 25 years, we'd have only mined 30% of the known resource. We're looking at building a sustainable operation with producing the lowest carbon footprint in both those minerals. And look, our current share price, currently around 23p, that's about 10% of our NPV, or about 4 months of our future EBITDA. Very quickly, an overview of Cassia. It's the first rutile dominant deposit found in over 70 years. It's a one-of-a-kind deposit. No one else has a rutile deposit with graphite or a graphite deposit with rutile. It's hosted in what's known as saprolite. So think of that as almost just hardened soil. It's not hard rock. There's no drilling, blasting, crushing, grinding of this material. You scoop it up and you process it. It's what's known as a blanket star mineralization from surface. So think of a cake you buy from Sainsbury's, where you've got the sponge and you've got icing on top. The mineralization is basically the icing on top. It sits there on surface. We haven't bothered drilling more than 30 meters down because that's where we start hitting hard rock. Everything that's high grade sits within the first 5 meters. We're located in Malawi. We have very strong governmental support. We have very strong local community support. On the social side, we had an announcement this week that we have just brought on board as part of the Sovereign team, the old First Quantum Minerals team from Zambia, where they helped First Quantum Minerals build out their copper mines, Sentinel and Kansanshi there. Exceptional infrastructure in place. This is not a bad a bad graphic to show that. You can see that Nacala corridor, that's the railway. It actually just touches the bottom end of the mineralized zone there. I want to just talk very quickly about the Rio Tinto investment. As a former investment banker and having been at the vanguard of doing this this deal with Rio, you can expect it's a little bit convoluted, but to try and dumb it down to its bare bones, essentially, Rio in July invested $40 million for 15% of the project. They have an option to go up to 19.99%, which expires in July 2024. That option takes them up to the 19.99%, because post that, under ASX regulations, they'd have to make a mandatory bid for the entire company. Now, once we announce a DFS, Rio has 180 days to exercise what's known as an option to be operator of Cassia. Now, feel free to go on Rio Tinto's website, but Rio do not operate mines on behalf of junior mining companies. So read into that option what you will. Rio's going to help us qualify our graphite for the lithium-ion battery space. Graphite is 50% of a lithium-ion battery. You can imagine someone like a Sovereign Metals trying to find the right person in a Ford or a Volvo or a BMW to talk to about who do I sell my graphite to is a bit of an arduous task. Now we have Rio Tinto on board. They already have global MOUs and supply chains with these car manufacturers. They can do that for us. If we decide to construct the mine and look at a funding package, Rio will help us with the development finance. We haven't discussed in what shape or form that may take at this point in time. Very quickly, I could see when I said Rutile, some blank faces. What is this guy talking about? Rutile is essentially titanium, and I'll get onto it. But titanium itself, $25 billion industry. Most titanium ends up as titanium dioxide in the pigment space, where it's used as white paint or white pigment within paints, within plastics, coatings, paper, etc. 7% ends up as titanium metal, so landing gears of jets within the defense industry, satellites, etc., medical applications, hip joints, dental implants, that's all titanium metal. And Apple's getting into the game with their new iPhone made out of titanium as well. And a little bit ends up in this welding industry, but specifically rutile ends up in the welding industry. So titanium's not actually a scarce commodity. It's the ninth most abundant element in the Earth's crust. But commercially viable titanium is a different story. Titanium that's commercially mined is mined in two different minerals, ilmenite and rutile. Ilmenite, common, low purity, lots of ilmenite players out in the market. The usual grade of ilmenite in terms of a TiO2, or the commercial part of ilmenite, 30 to 60%. The price of ilmenite, around $280 a ton. Rutile, very scarce, very high purity, over 95% TiO2. The price of rutile currently reported at almost $2,200 a ton, so eight times more than your ilmenite. Why is that? Because of the low purity of ilmenite, if you want high-grade titanium feedstock to go into the pigment space, go into high-quality metals, you have to process it. You have to process it to a higher grade. And those processes are energy-intensive, carbon-intensive, lots of smelting or roasting. And ultimately, you end up with a product that's still not anywhere near the 95%. Sovereign Metals is one of only two companies listed in the UK, or pretty much anywhere, that have rutile as its dominant commodity. So if rutile is so great, why doesn't everyone just mine rutile and leave ilmenite in the ground? It's because there's not enough rutile in the world. 95% of titanium feedstock, which is over here on the left-hand side, which is increasing by 3% a year for the next 10 years, 95% of that today comes from ilmenite. Only 5% comes from rutile. Now, unfortunately, the supply of, or fortunately for us, the supply of rutile is diminishing massively. The two major contributors to the rutile supply market are Base Resources, which has gone on record to say that their mine runs out of material in December 2024, so that's the end of this year, and Sierra Rutile, which runs out of production and taking out another 150 or so thousand tons of rutile in the next 2.5 years. What we're looking to put into the market will not take rutile back to where it is today. So rutile is half the story and half our revenue. The other half is graphite. And graphite, I'm sure many of you have come across graphite explorers, developers, telling you how, you know, it ends up in lithium-ion batteries. To quote Orwell, all graphite is equal, but some graphite is more equal than others. I say that because not all graphite will work in your lithium-ion battery. It requires certain chemical compositions, such as high purity, high crystallinity. It needs to work electrochemically within a battery a number of cycles before you can say, yes, I'll put that in my lithium-ion battery and sell it to a Ford or a Tesla or whoever. Now, we as Sovereign Metals actually started as a graphite company, and we had been looking for graphite in Malawi for the best part of 6 or 7 years before we stumbled upon this discovery. During that time, we had actually proven up another resource, another graphite project, which we've subsequently sold off. The graphite there is identical to the graphite at Cassia. What we know about that graphite, having done all the electrochemical work, is it is a premium product for the lithium-ion battery space. As I mentioned, we'd be the largest and lowest cost producer of natural graphite outside of China. The lower your bar on this chart, the lower your costs, the wider your bar, the higher your production. We are the widest and lowest. So just running through the key outcomes from our pre-feasibility study, and bearing in mind this had no input from Rio Tinto, this was solely Sovereign Metals as a standalone company. What could we achieve with this tier one asset? Which is probably not as much as a Rio Tinto could achieve with this asset. But for $600 million of capex to first production, we'd have a $1.6 billion net present value project, so almost three times your initial outlay. We'd have a post-tax IRR of 28%. We'd be producing 220,000 tons of rutile and 240,000 tons of graphite for 25 years. All lovely numbers, all great. There's one number I'd like you to focus on. That's the average annual EBITDA, which I mentioned. Once you have a business producing about $500 million a year of gross margin, you become quite relevant to even the majors in the mining space. Very importantly, a lovely production profile on the right-hand side, above it, a little strap line. 25 years production mines 30% of the known resource. So the reality is this could go on for 70, 80, 90 years. I'll finish off with just a little bit on the capital structure. So a market cap of about £130 million today puts us in the not-so-small part of the AIM market. But when you look at the potential of what we actually have, you can see there's quite some runway for a re-rate there. our major shareholders outside of Rio Tinto. We as management, we still own 11% of the company, fully intertwined with our shareholders. Sprott Inc. out of the US holds 8%, and below the reportable threshold are a number of UK, US, Swiss, and Singaporean funds who all hold part of our company. And I'll wrap it up there for questions.
Thank you, Sapan. So I'm just thinking, your investment case has been assisted ever so slightly by the fact that China has got really strict export restrictions. Now, should, in the unlikely case that China lessens those export restrictions, would that impact your investment case at all?
So I've always had this underlying assumption, and when I say I mean myself and the rest of the team. If you're the lowest cost producer in any commodity, you're the last person standing, I should say. So really, commodity prices, yes, they fluctuate. They go up and down and margins get squeezed and then you have windfall years. But over time, you know, as long as you can supply into the market at the cost that you're saying, you'll be fine. So we're not too worried about what China does or doesn't do. But it does, what it does do, and China putting curbs on graphite back in December, they talked about it in October, did it in December, what it has done, it's woken up a lot of people who were just thinking this critical minerals thematic is, you know, a nice to have. You know, it's not really applicable to the real world. And now all of a sudden we're like, okay, if we don't have graphite, we can't build electric vehicles, we can't electrify, we can't have batteries or powering everything. What do we do instead? You know, and the US, Japan, the EU are all mobilizing a lot of money, a lot of people in order to secure that supply from anywhere they can right now.
Okay, just one more from me before I open it up. So you're not so bothered about what China does, but you are bothered about what Rio Tinto does. So they have this option to be an operator for you, but how dependent is that on the outcomes of the DFS?
I would say if it wasn't, it's less about the outcomes of the DFS, I'll put it that way. It's more about Malawi is a new jurisdiction for Rio. Graphite, we are the only exposure Rio Tinto has to graphite. Conversely, we're the only graphite player with a major involved. They need to get happy with Malawi. They need to get happy with graphite. They need to get happy with a lot of things that worry blue chip companies a lot more than they worry junior mining companies. Junior mining companies spend a lot of time figuring out what does the resource look like, what do the economics look like, what's the geology, what's the processing, etc., etc. When you're a FTSE 100 company, reputation matters, your supply chain matters, your value chain, your personnel, they all matter. And these, you know, social, environmental, these are all the points that, you know, Rio Tinto bring along into the mix for us.
That was intriguing, wasn't it? Is Malawi a happy place?
Hi, a couple of questions. First of all, could you talk about Malawi's mining laws and what other mining companies are there? What experience do they have in mining, or are they brand new to mining?
Sure. I would say they're very green to mining. There's only one mine that has been built in Malawi, and that was the Kayelekera uranium mine. That was built by a company called Paladin Energy. Fully built, operational, and then within a year or so, the Fukushima disaster happened. Uranium prices came off. That went into care and maintenance. There is a company now who are trying to restart Kayelekera. There are a few other explorers and developers in Malawi. We are by far one of the biggest projects there. We are a project of national significance. We'd be something like 10% of the GDP once up and running. The laws, there is mining law set out. There's a fiscal regime set out, so just very quickly, 5% revenue royalties, 30% corporation tax, and they'd have a 10% free carry in, the government would have a 10% free carry in the project. All that fiscal regime is built into the economics I showed you. When you've got a project this size, and it's going to run for 70 years, what tends to happen is a bilateral discussion between the operator and the government to understand what are the true most beneficial fiscal parameters for both those parties. And that's what's going to happen with Cassia.
Got two questions.
Sure.
First of all, what's the split of revenue between the two?
50-50.
Okay.
Revenue, EBITDA 60-40, just because in our modelling we've used a little bit higher rutile price than a graphite price.
Yeah, obviously it depends. And the second one is the capex for the mine. I know it's it looked a very large capex for quite a straightforward mining process. You said you'd take it off the first 5 metres. Is that just because it's a very large mine?
Sorry, what was that?
The capex is a relatively large looking capex because it's a relatively large mine.
It's a huge operation.
Okay.
I mean, for a project this size, it's going to be a big operation. 24 million tons per annum is quite a considerable ask for any mining project out there.
So I was having a look at
Thank you. And just very briefly, do you also depend on any third-party infrastructure that is yet to be built, or if you have the product, can you take it to the market?
Yep. All the infrastructure's there. I think I showed you very quickly.
It's like railways.
The railway, yep. The rail goes straight to the port of Nacala in Mozambique. That's the deepest and one of the busiest ports in Mozambique. We've done all the work. What does it take? How much does it cost us to take our product from that point onto a vessel ready to go anywhere in the world? It costs us less than $100 a ton for a product that today would sell for well over $2,000 a ton.
Thank you.
Excuse the lack of knowledge about rutile.
Sure.
This is the first time I heard of it, but. What do you use your rutile for? I mean, do you sell it? And I haven't heard you mention, let's say, rutile quartz.
No, so what we would be producing is a 95% rutile concentrate. That concentrate goes straight to pigment plants, goes straight to metal, titanium metal producers, goes straight into the welding industry.
Sorry?
Straight into the welding industry, for example. And those are the three main streams that we're looking at for the rutile.
Thank you.
So very quickly, when you produce a ton of pigment that goes into white paint, the pigment producers around the world, these are big guys, you know, they have multi-billion dollar facilities all over the place. They look, the pigment they produce for white paint is TiO2. Now, the closer you can get to that TiO2 number, the better. When you're giving them 95, 96% TiO2, they only got to do a little bit of work to turn it into the 100%.
So just looking ahead to when it's being extracted, I was looking on your website, and is it extracted using water? And if so, water is a precious commodity. What happens with that water?
You're alluding to hydro mining, which is what we've built into the concept of the pre-feasibility study. It's essentially high-powered water jets, cannons, hitting this material. The material basically just falls into pieces, ends up in the water. That creates a slurry. Slurry gets pumped into a processing plant where we separate the heavy stuff from the light stuff. The heavy stuff is the titanium. The light stuff is graphite. Really that simple. Water is a precious commodity, and in many parts of Africa, it's very precious. The tropical climate of Malawi, the fact that it's got a rainy season, means we're okay with it. With the hydro work that we've done, And the water balance we've done is, if we were to build our mine, we'd use 2% of the rainfall.
Finally, I'm thinking about serendipity. So here you are, you've proven up another resource, and yet I wonder what you're going to do with that other resource. But quite by chance, here's one deposit yielding both. So that's the serendipitous element for me.
We've spun the other resource off. So our shareholders got a little windfall from that, some free shares in a new graphite company called NGX that's set up. So if you just like graphite, feel free to buy those shares. If you got interested by anything I said, then please have a look.
Very good. Serendipity. Thank you. That's the word for your presentation tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.